Well, that was a powerful song. Powerful voice. Thank you so much. Where's Ellen? Thank you for that children's story. That is amazing how God works and how He leads. And as you know, we're going to be holding an evangelistic series, and so I'm hoping that each one of you are praying every single day. And I'm praying through Joel chapter 2. We're told that at the end of time, prior to the coming of Christ, that God will pour out His Spirit upon all flesh. We cannot accomplish the task that God has given to us without the Holy Spirit, can we? But I'm thankful that this work doesn't depend upon us doing something for God, but God doing something despite our weaknesses and our frailties. But yes, there is human cooperation. And so I'm looking forward to the upcoming series of meetings. I know that we haven't done an evangelistic campaign in quite some time. So I believe that the Holiday Inn seminar room will be packed with people. I really believe that. I believe we're going to have a great response, and we're going to see many people join this prophetic movement. So let's pray to that end. Well, last Sabbath when we were together, we talked about something that Jesus wants you and I to be. Do you remember that? God wants us to be the salt of the earth. Now, how does salt lose its saltiness? Remember that? We talked about that. You have sodium, you have chloride. And sodium has how many electrons that surrounds its nucleus? Remember that? It has the atomic number of 11, right? And so in the outer shell, it's wanting to receive 7 electrons or get rid of one. It's wanting to get rid of one. Now, chloride has the atomic number of 17, and it is needing to receive one instead of getting rid of the 7 that are in the third orbital ring. So when sodium and chloride come together, sodium gives away an electron and chloride receives one. Then these two elements join together to form sodium chloride. Remember that? The little chemistry lesson that we had. And so I had mentioned that God the Father gives us His beloved Son, Jesus Christ. As sodium gives an electron, so God the Father gives us His beloved Son. And we, like chloride, must receive that wonderful gift. And if we receive Jesus Christ into our hearts, we then become the salt of the earth. Now, we looked at several examples of men that were the sodium chloride in their day and age. Remember that? Abraham, when he was told by God Himself that the men and women dwelling in the wicked cities of Sodom and Gomorrah would be destroyed. Obviously, when we went to Genesis chapter 18, Abraham had a conversation with God, right? Lord, if you find 50 righteous individuals dwelling in the wicked cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, won't you spare these cities? And what did God say? Indeed, I will. What about 45? Yep. 40? Yep. 30, 20, 10? God said to Abraham, if I find 10 righteous individuals dwelling in the wicked cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, I will spare them. So what was going on? Was Abraham the salt of the earth in his day and age? Yes, he was. What was his burden? What was his passion? He was wanting to preserve life. And then we looked at Daniel, that godly man, when he stood before Nebuchadnezzar after receiving the exact same dream that this powerful monarch had. As he went before the king, he said to Arioch, hey, listen, spare the lives of who? Do you remember that narrative, that story? What's that? Of the magicians and the soothsayers and the Chaldeans, the wise men of his realm that were given over to the kingdom of darkness. And yet Daniel had such a love for humanity, God's creation, that he said, listen, even though they're on the wrong side of the fence, Lord, please save them. So when God and humanity join together, there is a burden to preserve life. And that was in the life of Christ. He didn't come to destroy. In fact, John 10:10 says, the thief comes to steal, to kill and destroy. But Jesus said, I have come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. So if Christ is dwelling in the heart, we will have a passion to preserve life, so that people have time to get to know how good God is. Remember when Peter, James, and John and the disciples were traveling through that city of Samaria? Now, the common courtesy of the day and age was to offer whoever was traveling through the city, offer them food, water, and lodging. But because Jesus had his focus on Jerusalem, none of the Samaritans invited Christ or his disciples into their home for food, water, and relaxation. And how did James and John respond to that? Remember that? Hey, listen, we remember when we were little boys in Sabbath school class, we were taught the story of Elijah, and when an apostate ruler within God's camp sent that captain with the 50 men to capture Elijah. Remember what Elijah, we know exactly what he said, and rain fire down and burn up these wicked people. So that's what Peter, James, and John said, right? And Jesus responded by saying, listen, that's not what I'm about. I have not come to destroy the lives of men and women. I have come to save. Yes, you and I are called to be the sodium chloride of the earth. And the only way that we can be the salt of the earth is if our frail humanity is connected with God's divinity. And I appreciated the lyrics to the song this morning. God is faithful. We have been unfaithful over and over. But God is faithful, and we need his faithfulness lived in and through us for his honor and glory. And if Christ is dwelling in us, then his Spirit is dwelling in us. And if his Spirit is dwelling in us, then we will go about doing good and seeking to be a blessing wherever we're planted. Acts 10, verse 38, Jesus was filled with the Holy Spirit, and he was filled with power, and he went about doing good and helping who? All who were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. That is the Spirit of heaven. In fact, Ellen would write, when the Spirit to bless others springs constantly from within, we are fitted for heaven, for we have heaven within our hearts. Isn't that pretty amazing? When the Spirit to bless others springs constantly from within, we are ready for heaven. Why? Because we have heaven dwelling within our hearts. That is the Spirit of Christ. That's what we find in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Everywhere Jesus went, he wanted to be a blessing to his family and his children. Now this morning, we're going to look at a sermon that I have entitled The Freedom Bird. But to begin, I would like to invite you at this time to bow your head. Hey, it didn't pop. Bow your heads for an additional word of prayer. Father in heaven, we are gathered here this morning to hear your voice on this special communion service. Lord, we're here to acknowledge you, not only as the great creator of heaven and earth, but we are here to acknowledge you as the Savior of all mankind, especially of those who believe. We know that without your shed blood on the cross, none of us would be alive right now. So we owe everything to you. The bread that we eat day in and day out, the water we drink has been purchased by your spilled blood. And so we acknowledge you as the Savior of all mankind, especially of those who believe. Speak to us now through your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Now it was, it was dreaded, it was feared. It was incurable. Doctors really didn't know how to treat it. Victims of this disease eventually became unrecognizable. Why? Because it disfigured their faces, their hands, their feet, their whole body. It even ate away their internal organs. And you could say it was no respecter of persons. It didn't matter if you were born to wealth or poverty. If it came knocking on your door, it was too late. Listen, you could not run from it. You could not hide from it. Those who contracted it lived very lonely, solitary lives. Yes, they were separated from family. They were separated from friends. Now, there was a young rabbi that caused quite a stir. People said he could heal the sick. They said, yes, listen, I have watched him open the eyes of the blind. I have seen men and women who were paralyzed, and Jesus caused them to walk. Yes, this young rabbi caused a stir. And people were repeating Psalm 103, verse 3. He forgives all our iniquities, and he heals all our diseases. Yes, wherever he went, people repeated his manifesto. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed. Now, I want you to look with me at an amazing story that we find in Mark chapter 1. If you brought your Bible this morning, turn now to Mark chapter 1, a familiar story. Mark chapter 1, and drop down to verse 40. The second book in the New Testament, Mark chapter 1, and drop down to verse 40. Mark chapter 1, beginning in verse 40. The Word of God says, "Now a leper came to him, imploring him, kneeling down to him and saying to him, if you are willing, you can make me clean.' Then Jesus, moved with compassion, stretched out his hand and touched him and said to him, 'I am willing, be cleansed.' As soon as he had spoken, immediately the leprosy left him, and he was cleansed. He was healed. And he strictly warned him and sent him away at once and said to him, 'See that you say nothing to anyone, but go your way, show yourself to the priest, and offer for your cleansing those things which Moses commanded as a testimony to them.'" And then verse 45, "However, he went out and began to proclaim it freely and to spread the matter so that Jesus could no longer openly enter the city, but was outside in deserted places. And they came to him from every direction." Isn't that a powerful story? A leper comes to Jesus. A mycobacterium has entered his body. It begins to rot away his flesh. You cannot recognize him if you were one of his family members. He now lives in a leper colony. And in that leper colony, how the message got to the men and women who dwelt there, no one really knows. But somehow he heard about this young rabbi who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Yes, this leper had a measure of faith, but the faith dwelling in his heart and mind was dormant until he heard about Jesus Christ. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And when he discovered that Jesus was going to be in a certain region, not too far from the leper colony, what did he do? He said, "I'm going to take a chance. I'm going to take a chance. I miss my wife. I miss my family. I miss my friends." He took a chance, and when he saw the miracle worker, this young rabbi from the city of Nazareth, he falls to his knees and he says, "Listen, if you are willing, I know you can make me clean. I've heard one story after another. I believe that you are my only hope for a bright future." And so according to the narrative, he falls to his knees, he pleads with Jesus, and notice this, the Word of God says Jesus was moved with what? Compassion. Compassion. Now in the Bible, the word compassion is an action word. You cannot have compassion and not do anything for someone, right? You and I can talk about compassion, can't we? But someone that has genuine compassion for others will do things to be a blessing for that individual or the people that need help. And Jesus, moved with compassion, reaches out and touches the untouchable. And then says these words, "I am willing, be thou healed." Now there is a major difference between the Word of man and the Word of God. The Word of God contains creative power to accomplish the will of God. Jesus said, "I am willing, be thou cleansed." And the word and the word that brought the universe into existence, the power that brought the universe into existence, were in the words of Jesus. And the leper was healed instantly. Now, what I want to draw your attention to is something that Jesus said to the leper after he was healed. What did Jesus say to the leper? "Hey, listen, I want you to go and find one of the local priests, and I want you to offer a sacrifice that Moses in the law commanded." Now, we can learn something very profound, and I'm going to kind of wrap it up. But in Leviticus chapter 14, it's called the Law of the Leopard. It's profound. It's probably the clearest presentation in the Old Testament on the good news of salvation that we find in Jesus Christ. Now, what was the Law of the Leper? Well, if you had leprosy and you fell to your knees and you opened up your heart to God and you asked for healing and he looked upon you with compassion and healed you, then you were required to be examined by the priest. And they had leper colonies in the Old Testament too. So you were brought before the priest, he would examine you, and then he said, okay, by the way, the priest would leave the camp and meet the leper outside the camp. He would examine the leper, and then he had something that the leper was required to do. He was to bring two clean birds, a clay pot, a pitcher of water, scarlet hyssop, and then, this is just incredible, incredible. The priest would take one of the birds and break its neck over the clay vessel as the leper was pouring water into it. So the water and the blood mingled together. Then the living bird was plunged into the watery blood. What happened next? The priest then took that living bird and in the presence of the leper who was cleansed, who was healed, threw it up in the air and let it go free.
Amen.
Isn't that profound? I mean, just think about that. You're separated from family and friends. Your body is rotting away. God has mercy on you. He heals you of your leprosy. Then you are examined outside the camp by the priest. He pronounces you clean. Two birds are brought. One represents who? Jesus. And the other represents you and me. The bird that represents Christ is killed over the running water. And remember when the Roman centurion took a spear and thrust it into the side of Christ, what came out? Blood and water. Blood and water. And then in the presence of that leper who was miraculously healed, the priest took that living bird and threw it up in the air and set it free. If the Son shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. We are that freedom bird. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. We all have sinned and come short of His glory. And one of the probably the clearest ways that I know that I have fallen short of God's glory and need His shed blood is when I go shopping. I'm more interested in the items on my agenda list than I am about the salvation of the men and women who are walking by me. Sometimes I don't even think about what's going on. But if Jesus was shopping at Walmart and His mother wanted Him to pick up some things, do you think He would be more concerned about what's on the shopping list or the men and women in the store? How do I know that I need a Savior? That's a reality check for me. Because I know my Lord and Savior, everywhere He went, He had a burden for the lost. The good news is we are that leper, but Jesus wants to set us free from our guilt. We have a complete Savior in Jesus Christ, don't we? In His humanity, He conquered sin and death. And we need to be saved from the guilt and punishment of sin, the power and slavery to sin, and the nature and principle of sin. Jesus not only is our justification, not only has He saved us from the guilt and punishment of sin through His holy history and His atoning death, but He wants to save us from the power and slavery to sin. And we call that sanctification. And I'm looking forward to the day when Jesus comes the second time in the glory of His Father with the angelic host, and this corruption shall put on what? Incorruption. Yes, in the future, when Jesus comes the second time, He will save us from the principle and nature of sin. So in Jesus Christ, you have a complete Savior. He has saved you, past tense, from the guilt and punishment of sin. He is saving you right now from the principle of sin. And one day soon, He will transform us, our fallen natures. Isn't that good news? And so if the Son shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. Go back and read Leviticus chapter 14 about the freedom bird. It's one of my favorite passages in the Old Testament. Why? Because I identify with that bird that was set free. I know my history. I know my weaknesses. I know my flaws. I know my shortcomings. And at times, I have to go to Jesus and weep at His feet and say, Lord, please forgive me. Now here's the good news. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. If we confess our sins, He is faithful, we learned in that song. He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to what? Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now listen, we can't earn God's forgiveness. We're accepted in the Beloved, and we're forgiven by virtue of the holy history of our Lord and Savior. But Jesus doesn't come to us harboring any negative feelings in His heart towards you and me, does He? No, He comes to us with an attitude of forgiveness. So then why must we confess our sins to receive forgiveness? Well, the Greek word for forgiveness is aphiemi, and it means not only to pardon, but to remove and send forth. So Jesus comes to us, not harboring any angry feelings towards us. The problem is not in the heart of God. The problem is in our heart. We're at enmity with Him at times, aren't we? We're fighting and warring against Him. So Jesus comes with a spirit of forgiveness. Listen, my child, I am not against you. I am for you. I have forgiven you on the cross of Calvary, but forgiveness is more than pardon. Now I want you to give me permission to come into your heart and take that thing that is weighing you down and remove it from you and send it forth from you. That is biblical forgiveness. Isn't that good news? And God is going to do that. So whatever is weighing you down right now, your Savior loves you. He has paid an infinite price for your eternal salvation. And there's a major difference between human love and God's divine love. We are told that God loves us with an everlasting love. Way back in the days of eternity, before you were born, God began to love you, because He knew in His infinite mind, with His foreknowledge, that you would come into existence. He loves you in eternity past, eternity present, and eternity future. He will love you for all eternity. Whether you are saved or lost, He will love you for all eternity. And we're told in Romans chapter 5 that while we were yet sinners, wicked, ungodly, He demonstrated His love for us. Jesus didn't go around saying, well, I love you too, and I love you. No, He demonstrated His great love for His children through His actions and through His words. You cannot earn God's love or acceptance. We receive it as a gift, don't we? In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, we're told that God's love never fails. That doesn't mean you're not going to face difficulties in this old world. But when you go through the difficulties, God will not forsake you. He will not leave you. He will be by your side, encouraging you and upholding you. Aren't you thankful for such a revelation that we find in sacred Scripture? If the Son shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. As we celebrate now the communion service, I want you to visualize in your mind that you are that bird plunged under the water and the blood. You are that bird that the priest is holding tenderly in his hands. You are that bird that he throws up into the air and he lets it go, experiencing genuine freedom. If the Son shall make you free, you shall be what? Free indeed. You are that freedom bird. I am that freedom bird. Isn't that good news? Well, at this time, we're going to separate for the foot washing service. As Seventh-day Adventists, we follow the example of Jesus, because in John chapter 13, we are told that we are to wash each other's feet. And the principle behind this ceremony that we're celebrating right now is that we are here not to be served, but to serve others. And what really touches my heart is that the great Creator of heaven and earth put a servant's apron around his waist, and he knelt down and began to wash the dirty feet of his disciples. Wait a minute. The King of the universe, the great Creator, stoops as a menial servant and washes the dirty feet of his disciples. Yeah, you know what else touches my heart? We're told when we get to heaven and we're sitting at the banquet hall, Jesus will once again put a servant's apron around his waist, and he will come up to us and serve us. This was not some Hollywood production that occurred over 2,000 years ago. This is the heart of God. Whoever is chief among you, let him be your servant. And you know something? In eternity, Jesus will be serving us. And in response, we're going to say, no, no, no. We need to be serving you. Awesome. Awesome. Well, may God bless you as you contemplate His Word today. And I have no idea where we go. Thank you. Our Father in heaven, we want to thank you for being with us today. We want to thank you for speaking to our hearts. Lord, we are that freedom bird. You have let us go. You have set us free from the guilt and condemnation of our sins. And if the Son shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. We want to acknowledge that you died an ignominious death, a very horrible, horrendous death, in order to save us. But it was not the physical pain that was the most excruciating for you, Father in heaven. It was the thought that sin would separate you from your Father. And Lord, we don't fully comprehend what you accomplished on the cross for our eternal salvation, your suffering, your agony. But Lord, as we grow in grace and in our knowledge of you, I just pray that you become more and more precious to us each and every day. I want to pray for all the children represented by the parents here and the grandchildren. We want to acknowledge that your Spirit is working in a mighty way in their lives. And we pray that we would not frustrate your grace. I want to thank you for finding jobs and being faithful and helping us in our times of difficulty. And Lord, it is our prayer that our children will choose to spend time with you every day in the study of your word and through prayer. And when you come in the clouds of glory, may not one of our children, grandchildren, and possibly great-grandchildren, may not one be missing. And we will give you all the praise, glory, and honor. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.